Welcome, everyone. It is my distinct honor and pleasure to welcome each and every one of you here tonight to hear these two fabulous men tell their horrific stories of injustice. What they've been through is remarkable. It's something no one should even have to think about, much less experience. I want to start by thanking Mario Hardy and All Souls Church for giving us the space tonight, and thank each of you for coming out this evening to spend time with us to hear the stories of Lawrence Hayes and Mark Clements. So I'd like to start off with Lawrence Hayes, and I'll do a brief introduction. I don't want to take much more of our time. I know we're getting a late start, and we're here till about 8:30 or so. So I appreciate your patience while we wait to get started. So after Lawrence, then I'll give a brief introduction of Mark, and we'll take it from there. And then at the end, we'll have time for Q&A. So if you have any comments or questions, you're more than welcome to bring them at that time. So, all right, Lawrence Hayes. Lawrence Hayes is an amazing man who I had the pleasure of meeting many years ago, pretty much right after he was released. I want to say it was the early 90s. So Lawrence will tell you his story, so I don't want to take too much of it and tell it for him. But as you will learn, he started off in the 60s with the Black Panther Party and was very active, working with breakfast program, fighting heroin in the communities. And unfortunately, he was framed for murdering a police officer, which he did not do. He was innocent of that crime and sent to death row in 1971. He was only on death row for a couple of years because of the Furman decision that temporarily abolished the death penalty or put a moratorium on the death penalty across the nation. And so he was commuted at that time along with the other 600 or so men and women who were on death row to a life sentence. And then his time maxed out in the early 90s, so 1991, 20 years later, he was finally released. And let me tell you something about this man. He has not stopped. He hit the ground running. And when I met him, he was working at a needle exchange program for youth in, was it Harlem?
Yeah, it was
ACS program. And I was amazed by the work that he was doing, not only with ACS, but he was also co-founder of an organization that I've been involved with for at least, I don't know, about 7 years or so now, called the Campaign to End the Death Penalty. So he was co-founder of that organization, and that's how I met him, to interview him for some research that I was doing. And I asked him what the movement meant to him, and he said, the movement saved my life, so I owe my life to the movement. I'll never forget him saying that. And he has definitely been proving over the last, gosh, I'm afraid to say, is it 25 years now? 25 years that has passed that I can call Lawrence my friend, and I'm very honored to call him a friend because he's been not only just a survivor of death row, but an amazing activist fighting the death penalty or all kinds of injustices that are around. So without further ado, I'd like to turn the mic over to Lawrence and let you hear his story firsthand. Thank you.
Well, thank you for having me. It's an honor being here. I want to say a pleasure, but what we're fighting is, we're fighting for life, and there are too many people sentenced to death, and that's what we're here to talk about through my example and through my example of being in the death house. Let me tell you something a little about how this all started for me. I joined the Black Panther Party in 1968. I was 17 years old, and for me, it was a movement that I was attracted to because of racism. I grew up with racism all around me. I detested it, and I wanted to find a way to fight it. And the Black Panther Party offered that way. I got involved with the Black Panther Party. I started out. I was turned over to a community aide and tutor who got me a job at a public school. I was involved in the overall community control movement, the community school control movement in Ocean Hill, Brownsville. And then I knew martial arts, so they opened up a after-school martial arts program. And I'm assuming, just because I knew martial arts, I was approached to get involved in a group that was geared toward preventing drugs back then heroin from entering our communities. There was a lot of heroin all over the place. In case people don't know, just recently there was an article that indicated that Nixon instituted the war on drugs and targeted African Americans with that particular drug. But the group I was with, I used to watch Bill Cosby and I Spy. That's why Bill seems to be a friend of mine, and I have a lot of respect for him. But I was always this espionage thing, you know, I was always attracted to that kind of thing. And so I got involved in the group, and we were introduced to someone who had been a drug courier and had done time in jail, and the mafiosa didn't support him. So I got involved in this. We went on a couple of raids. What we would raid is called drug drop spots, where money and drugs meet at the same time, and you would be surprised. Movie theaters, clothing stores, street corners, backyards. I mean, this is the way drugs move. And money and drugs are switched on all levels, sometimes right in front of you. One person have a bag and give it to another person. He got the cash, the other got the drugs. So it happens in our cities all over. On one particular occasion, on August 21st, 1971, we were doing surveillance, and this incident occurred. Two of my comrades went in, because what would happen was, it was always either one or two people. They were normally always European Americans. They'd come up, they'd have the traditional, back then they had the paper shopping bag, the brown paper shopping bags, you know, and they would move, you know, they would come out the store, go wherever they were supposed to go, and the exchange would take place. They would get the money, they would give up the drugs. On this particular occasion, we were supposed to do surveillance to find out exactly where this stuff takes place. However, once my comrades got in, I heard gunshots. I ran to the place. I had no weapons on me. And I ran to, it was a delicatessen in Hollis, Queens. I ran to the door, and when I got there, it was a man standing at the door with a gun pointed at me. And I thought I was dead. But I wasn't. Suddenly he pitched forward. My comrade bumped up against me. I heard him go, which indicated something was wrong with him. He maybe took five or six steps behind me and fell. I went, once this guy fell with the gun, I turned to try and find out what was wrong with him. I bent down and a tree exploded, gunfire. I mean, it had to be like two or three people with guns shooting at it. I ducked behind the tree. I had always learned that, I hate to say it like this, but this is what I learned. Police are cowards. They want to live too, you know. So I followed my training. I looked around. I saw what were called, this is that night, I saw what were called blind spots, shadows. I connected the shadows, I reached down, I grabbed the gun from my comrade, and I shot in the air. And it's estimated that a person ducking would take anywhere from 10 to 15 seconds. Within 10 to 15 seconds, you can move from one shadow to another shadow, and they will believe you're still in that shadow. And that's what I did, and it worked, and I got away. I was later arrested at the Canadian border, not going to Canada, coming back from Canada. My training had kicked in, but my nephew was also my co-defendant, so to speak, my comrade. He had got arrested. And I was coming back because I wanted to help him. In my mind, we were going to either rally on a rally for him like we did for Huey P. Newton, or we're going to break him out of jail like we did Joanne Chesima, Ashanti Shakur. On my way back, but I got arrested. I was taken to I had to actually talk the police officer who had arrested me. He was an old man. He had this big 38 pointed at me, and he was and his hand was shaking. And I said, "Please, mister, I don't have no gun, blah, blah, blah." They took me to a police barracks. They offered me something to drink. I drank it. And the next time I remember in that phase and in that haze, be my head going back and forth, you know, just blurrily seeing police officers in front of me, you know. And when I woke up, I was coming off a plane at LaGuardia Airport. There was news, you know, there was flashes and all that kind of stuff. I didn't believe that. I had read the penal law before. And it was called the old law. Under the old law, you had to have a specific intent for them to convict you of a murder, even charge you with a murder, even indict you with a murder. You had to have a gun in your hand. You had to actually be the actual person who had pulled the trigger. But they told me, "Oh, that don't work no more. We got the new law." I couldn't believe they actually offered me 7 years if I went and testified against the courier, the guy who was helping to plan all of this. And I said no. First of all, I thought I knew the law. Second of all, I didn't think a jury would convict two kids. Execute, sentence two kids to murder. To death. And I was shook. I was shocked when they came back with the verdict. First of all, of guilt for murder. I didn't murder nobody. They know I ain't murdered nobody. So why would they convict me of murder? Then I just knew that they wouldn't give me the death penalty. And they did. So many things happened. It seemed like there was a whole ethnic group involved in this. You know, the judge name was Bosch. The district attorney name was Godello, you know. And I saw a juror sitting and reading the newspaper. It was incredible. The racism and the prejudice and the injustice that went on to convict me of a murder I never committed. I went to the death house. I spent 2.5 years in the death house. That was a trying experience, but while I was there, I became an artist. I had learned to meditate before I went to prison because I was into martial arts and Buddhism and stuff like that. I was obsessed, you might say, with learning about issues of life and death. And I spent almost my entire reading on issues of life and death in the Bible and history. And it occurred to me that somewhere along the line, humanity had lost all sense of appreciation, all collective sense of appreciation, value, and respect for life. And that one message is something I bring you today. I'm saying to you that humanity has to re-embrace its sense of appreciation, value, and respect for life. That is what my message is all about. The death penalty is only the peak of an attitude, of a mentality, in a world that shows far less appreciation, value, and respect for life than the human race or the human species needs to have to survive. You see, we are a part, we are not the only species on this planet. There are billions of species that make this planet live. And we are more about destroying those other species and ourselves, more so than we are about appreciating value and respecting our lives and their lives. And I believe that fighting the death penalty is fighting for generations to come. Because if we focus on appreciating, valuing, and respecting life, then we will eventually begin to work together to preserve this earth and civilization and other species for generations to come. And that's what this struggle, the human struggle, should be all about, preserving. We need to think about preserving this planet so we can say, guess what? Based upon our calculations, this little rock in this massive universe will be around for the next 200-300 years. We can guarantee that because we are taking care of it, because we are taking care of ourselves, and we are taking care of life as it exists on this planet. I want to thank y'all I've met a great many people who have influenced my life. You know, Sandy is one. I mean, when I hear a name, I smile, you know. And that's Sandy fights for life, you know. And I'm sure that everyone here feels the same thing. You know, that we need to show appreciation, value, and respect for life, and that the state who kills in our name, the state who kills in our name, you see, needs to embrace a great deal more appreciation, value, and respect for life. Thank you, and I appreciate being here.
That was great, Lawrence. So happy to hear your presentation, to see you after much too long. So really good. All right, thank you. So we'll have an opportunity to address Lawrence with any comments or questions after Mark's presentation. But now I'd like to turn our attention to Mark Clements. And Mark is actually the impetus for this gathering tonight because when he contacted me a month or two ago and said, I'm coming to the East Coast, let's do some work out there. I immediately contacted Lawrence, and when I found out he was coming to New York, I said, well, let's start this East Coast tour that you're going to be on, this whirlwind tour in New York. So I literally just picked him up, how many hours ago? 4 o'clock, so just a few hours ago, and he's already here speaking. And this is testament to how Mark rolls, right, Lawrence? He's just constantly, and Lawrence knows about this. He's definitely a machine. So Mark I met a little over 6 years ago, very soon after his release from unjust incarceration for a crime he did not commit. And he'll tell his story better than I can, of course, but he comes to us from Chicago, and you all may have heard of a very corrupt police precinct in Chicago led by John Burge. John Burge in Chicago oversaw for decades the inhumane torturing of over 100, maybe 200, I can give you a more accurate account, of young, almost exclusively black and brown boys and men into false confessions. Here in New York, you've certainly heard the story with the Central Park Five, but in Chicago, it's been huge proportions in this one police district. And it took decades for this to unfold and it to come to light after many of these boys turned to men were telling their stories from behind bars. And Mark was a mere 16 years old when he was framed for a murder, a quadruple murder, actually, that he did not commit, and tortured for a long time. And he'll share his story. Given juvenile life without parole sentence and thrown away into the prison system in Illinois for many years until he finally got out 28 years later. So we're going on almost 7 years since his release. And I'll never forget meeting him in that first convention when you first got out, Mark, also with the campaign, the death penalty. I'm sure Lawrence was there as well. So we started the campaign and death penalty out of Chicago. And Erlen definitely knows about this as well. That's where I know you. So anyway, Mark has been making up for lost time tenfold, hundredfold. Like Lawrence, when Lawrence came out, he hit the ground running. Same thing with Mark. And these two men are true activists and lovers of the people all over the place, if I ever met any of them. So it's perfect that we have them both here tonight. So let me shut up so you can hear who you really came to hear see, which is Mark Clemens and Lawrence. So Mark, I'd like to turn it over to you, and then we'll have some time for a Q&A then. Mark.
Good evening, and it is a pleasure to be here. Once again, my name is Mark Clemens. I am one of the administrators with the campaign to end the death penalty out of really Austin now. You know, dealing with the criminal justice system, we must face reality. The system is broken. It is sadly broken. We are people that know that it is sadly broken, but unfortunately, it seems that we have other things to do until maybe our families or friends become victimized by it. I don't like that type of wait back and see approach. That approach has left basically poor people in America to be just greatly legally lynched by a system that, first of all, has no integrity. Second of all, it's a system that is broken, so broken that it feels the need that even kids that maybe commit crimes, first-time offenders, they believe that they should never be afforded an opportunity of freedom. Well, I disagree. And I disagree because being locked up inside of a prison for 28 years of my life, being able to observe and to see young kids as myself enter into the system and to see these people grow. My only concern is, will these men and women be given a second opportunity? And some have. Miller versus Alabama has opened the door for some youth offenders. Unfortunately, prosecutors still remain to play what I call political football with their lives. Why? If you bring little Tony into a prison system and little Tony is in a street gang, little Tony is not going to change inside of the prison system, at least not immediately. And our system has had a habit, which it takes what these children have done once they have first entered into our prison systems, which provide them with inadequate education, that provides them with really no second chance opportunity. These kids literally have really no real desire to do right. And the reason I say that is due to the fact that there is nothing that is made available to them other than the fact that they believe that they will remain in prison and die. Back in 1981, being 16 years of age, taken down to a police station, placed inside of an interrogation room, handcuffed to two different rings, called Nigger Boy so much I thought it was my middle name. So, what do you do when you fall victim to the police? Who do you call? What do you do? So what I've seen across this country is generally little old ladies that are fighting for their children to be given an opportunity. Hearings where that prosecutors played games and withheld exculpatory evidence, or confessions that totally make no common sense. Well, I was one of those people. Being 16 years of age, no parent contacted, no youth officer, genitals grabbed and squeezed, beaten the chest, called nigger boy, and because there was a piece of paper that was good enough for the system, not one witness testified. Not one witness testified. However, that confession was strong enough to keep me bound inside of a place which did provide guys some opportunity when I first entered. However, this is a nation of people that felt that it had hit the jackpot when Bill Clinton was basically elected into office. Literally, what African American people and every individual who sits up here and they bag this man or even bag his wife, you really know not what you do. Here it is, a president that has spoke before the NAACP and has stated that his crime packages was approved based off of faulty data. We are people that hears this, but we do nothing about it. We uphold his wife and we try now to make it look like they have changed. They come from Pennsylvania through scandal, all the way to Arkansas, to the White House. Now, once we have a president that makes the White House, we all know that George Bush Jr., he had his problems. But standing in New York, and what most people fail to realize because they have been politically brainwashed, anytime you have a president and he brings in females right into secret chambers, how in the world is he going to have his data down pat? So here it is, a naive George Bush, someone who really wanted revenge against the country due to the fact that his father was a target. It just played hand in hand. Bill Clinton never opened his mouth. He kept it shut. Everything in those files were incorrect. So yes, there's many reasons we can jump on George Bush. But what really happened 9/11 is not a reason to jump on George Bush. Anytime you give someone faulty data, school buildings being hit over here in this country, Iraq, that's what people fail to realize. I'm sitting in a prison cell watching it, talking about, oh my gosh, is these people that dumb? And please forgive me for saying that. But it makes you think that way. Anytime you fall a victim to the criminal justice system, and here it is, no evidence mounts up, but you're there. Here it is, a crooked detective in the city of Chicago by the name of John Burge. John Burge was literally able to pick, like, craftily picking his victims. They come from the most poorest areas of Chicago. They come from some of the most disruptive households in the city of Chicago. And now you take them to a police station, you torture these individuals, judges. So we can't sit here and we can't say that this is all Caucasian issue, because I know different. Judges, African-American judges, watching men and women walk inside of, inside of their courtrooms like mummies. Not one question asked, how did he sustain his injury? What became more of value to our criminal justice system was the conviction rather than the injury of the source. So they had a systematic way of covering up, and they would provide these hearings just to turn them down. Little old mothers, because that's who it was, fathers basically absent, inside of these courtrooms, suffering mentally. That's why in the city of Chicago, I fought not just for torture reparations, meaning the psychological treatment to be administered to torture victims, but it should be administered to their families. Here it is, I see almost every time I go to court for someone, that little old lady, perhaps you'll see a girlfriend, but the bottom line of it is that we are not tired of being victimized. So we like it, just like ice cream and pie. So we sit there and we just suffer. And we say, what can we do? Well, we contact this person and contact that person, and nothing materialized, so we go sit down. We ain't learned how to use the media. We ain't learned when to shut the media down. We ain't learned how to pay close attention to our elected officials who we vote into office. So we still have picked among that 60-year-old political base. They move from office to office to office. That's all. Well, today he ain't the prosecutor. This week he the clerk. So now we sit here and we say that justice is going to arrive. Justice can't arrive with the same old mess in it. It must be some type of accountability with integrity. And without integrity, you shoot, but you miss. And I hit this person when I should have hit her. So now we see that our children have decayed. So we use that as an issue, and we say that they're violent and lock them up. Throw away the key. So now we strengthen all over America corrupt politicians who have a desire to carry out executions. So in the state of Texas, where there is roughly 240 individuals, in the state of California, which has the largest death row of this country, we walk around like we are blind people, and we say that we want some justice. No. As I was explaining earlier, Black life matters, little life matters, white life matters, green life matters, whoever. We must learn to come together, because the system for many years have pictured this day. They pictured this day being conquered and divided for a reason. Here it is, we go spend all of our little money in places of Nevada. We go spend all of our money in sunny Florida. We fail to realize those were the biggest racist belt places against African American people than we can ever even imagine. Get cross, get caught crossing the bridge that connects Miami and South Beach, and you ain't got a nice little money in the bank. You become to be a target. State of Texas, Rodney Reed. Here it is, a man. It's good enough to put you on death row. Very, very good. Based off of ineffective assistance of counsel of your own attorney. Failure to get up. Everybody with any type of legal sense knows. Well, the African-American community has been played like pawns. We're their tokens. Because we're the only race that sits down and act like, guess what? We don't know what to do. So the system loves us. And so by the system loving us, it creates other ways to draw people away. And it says, well, guess what? I hear that Lawrence Hayes and Mark Clemens over there speaking. Guess what? We're going to draw them away. So people don't look at the conspiracy mechanism of our criminal justice system. People don't look at the judge sitting up and he's running in and out of your community every day, shaking your hand, saying, you very nice. I love you people. You keep him a job, he send your people away. People ain't learned that. The correctional guards, they gotta live somewhere, so they live in your community too. They come and they say, hey, baby, I like you. Can I buy you a drink? Yeah, you know, but I got my brother and he locked up. You know who Tony Davis is? Yeah, I know who Tony Davis is. Man, we treating him real nice. Yeah, you are treating him real nice. You beating him, you depriving him of sleep, you depriving him of food, and you depriving him of justice. So here it is, we say, well, guess what? We really, really now finally hit the promised land. Barack Obama, gee gosh, let's dance. Let's hold a party in Grant Park in Chicago. Let's show it all over the nation. In Texas, man, what Bush was able to do, he got Texas looking beautiful. Because he gave back to his people. You know what Barack Obama gave back to his people? Handguns with stiff sentences. People ain't woke up to that fact because it's a political game. And we're the pawns of that political game. And we suffering. How many children can we lock up in the state of Pennsylvania? Michigan leads the nation in locking up kids and saying, guess what? You'll never get out. We sit back and we say that Michigan is decaying. You saw it. Man, they ain't got no properties up, man, everything falling apart. All that stuff is by design. Because if they didn't really have no money, they let them go. They would open up them prison doors in a heartbeat. Spending 28 years in prison, I really don't even think I did. Because I was a kid, naive. So I skip out like Peter Carpenter. But they say you open up that box, and you open up that box, you're going to come out running. Pew! No direction. Just let me out. You know, I'll find my way. So they say it's that way, okay, I'll keep running till I get well. Something look familiar. That's what happened when brothers get out of prison. Who messed them up? We did. And the reason I'm saying we, I'm a part of this society now. We did. We let bad policy take away their jobs. Take away their education opportunities. Take away their whole future. But when they go to jail, you know what we write them in letters and say? Well, man, when you get out, I hope you do better. They ain't gonna do better. He gonna do worse. We just lost a brother by the name of Timothy McKinley. Took a lot of work to get him out. He was on death row in Tennessee. Brother got out. But people can't understand one thing. If you ain't got no job, you going back to prison. You going back to prison. So we are a nation of people who sits here and we believe in falsehood and calling falsehood to be true. So the politician may say, man, I love you. From Bernie Sanders to Hillary Clinton, Mr. Bill just loves us. He'll probably pull out his saxophone and play us a tune or two. Due to the fact that we ain't woke up. We haven't woke up. We have broke the chains of slavery somewhat, but we still ain't woke up. We don't even realize who the enemy is. It shouldn't be here in America where that a black kid walks down the street, the black kid decides he wants to be buck naked and he walks down the street. But it shouldn't lead to his death and he don't have a weapon. It should lead to his death when the police officer who drives up clearly sees. Where are you gonna conceal it? What's gonna make the police officer so fearful of that kid? And that kid is a great distance away. And you just jump out your car and say, oh man, look like he high off PCP. Boom, boom, boom. So we're a nation who say, well, guess what? He's a black man. Man, we can't be doing that. Man, sure, we sent the, if he was white man, we'll be out here standing. Excuse my expression, and I won't say this because there's a kid in the room. But I basically said, forget you, Austin, Texas. Because you people don't know what you're doing. You can't be a friend with the enemy and then receive justice. I show you how to take this sucker down. Come on to the board meeting. What you do? First of all, if you ain't got a dollar, you can't win. You cannot beat these people. So I stood up and said, listen, if you don't fire them, I'm suing you. You know why? Due to the fact, the same way they put that bullet in that child could go in me. The same way they put that bullet in that child could go in this young child here too. So we ain't learned about mobilizing for our tomorrow. It ain't about protecting this person or that person. We gotta learn to stick together. No sticking together, we lose. Executions, oh, I'm talking about Texas, just love it. I was just there, they got a big old party going all in the street. Ludacris, Charlie Wilson, and all of them. Just a big old party. They don't have no common sense what's going on in the news. Texas said, well, today we executed another one in Texas and blah, 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 blah. Hey, man, did you see that they executed them? Oh, man, sure, I didn't know. So we lose. Here is a Troy Davis executed. Why in the world was Troy Davis executed? He was executed based off of the same evidence. The same evidence that convicted him, they didn't want to accept back. It was good enough to convict him, but it wasn't good enough to exonerate him. They called the witnesses a liars then. Uh-oh, shoot, they're a bunch of liars. So yeah, I have a problem with it. I have a problem with my people. And as I speak here, I don't run from them. So I get death threats too. Sure. I just laugh. Eat it like Fruit Loops. Due to the fact that in reality, if you're going to change anything, you can run. Everybody got to play a role in this. Maybe I might be good at speaking. Maybe the other one may be good at writing. Maybe the other one may be good at taking videos. Maybe the other one may have a little radio station. So if we don't work together, we lose. The system knows that. So they just laugh at us. Donald Trump comes to Chicago and get chased out of Chicago. You know what Donald Trump really said? Ah, man, so what? Man, gas the jet up. I'm going to Ohio. That's where he went. Immediately. Here it is, people all out there talking about, get Donald Trump. Donald Trump in Ohio, man. You fighting his staff. You ain't fighting Donald Trump. Yes, they are devils. But the bottom line of it is, guess what? Once you win a victory, take your mind off that victory, start working on that other victory. It's so much injustices that have occurred and affected us in this nation. And this is the most brothers I have seen in one room. Three. We'll make it five with me and Lawrence. Five brothers. Almost outnumber the women. I think we are five and no, it's six. We ain't learned one thing. That's how it's going to change. When the brothers get mad. When that brother lose that son that was dear to him. Because won't we tell you? Being and going to Bastrop, Texas, and Sandra Reed, she's suffering. Because this is what happened. Everybody who was tortured that came out of prison, guess what? They got mental problems. Every last one. So everybody sit around and say, well, man, shoot, you finally did it. Justice, peace. Man, put my hand down. Because I got a whole different road to work yet. Yeah, man, y'all did it. No, we didn't. Because when we tell you these mental scars, that's what African-American people forget. That's what everybody who played roles with winning the freedom of these brothers out of these prisons. It's a role to play. And once we play those roles effectively and we bring those brothers out of those situations, what we learn is this. Those men suffer. They can't get a job. They may have a girlfriend, still can't get a job. She said, hey, why don't you take me on a $10 movie? You can't even give her $10 because you don't have it. So that means you got to go break in somebody's store, break in their house, or hit somebody upside the head to get $10 to survive. I've seen females get right off of the prison bus, and they waiting there for Chuck. Say, oh, man, my man Chuck, he on his way. Yeah, I know he on his way. Chuck never come. You know what they got to go do, Neil? They got to return back to the familiar. So you know what the system say? Ah, well, they didn't report. Put a warrant out on them. So now they become to be pawns of the criminal justice system, and they suffer from New York to Delaware, all over. That game is being played. And we ain't learned to tell the system we can change Bill Clinton's crime package in one day. Faith without works is dead. That sucker dead. Because you got to do something. So people sit around and say, oh, Hillary, I just love you. And you know what Hillary said about her, bro? Yeah, suckers, just give me an office. Just give me an office. I'm going to show you what this stuff is. We're going to speed up this and we're going to do this. Say, because let me tell you, you dummies ain't even had enough of us. And I hate to say and to put the sister down or to put the brother down, but in reality, they're tarantulas. And people don't see. All of these political people in the last 60 years have been tarantulas towards, guess what, poor people. I hear people say, well, man, to the black race. No, you got white people locked up in there too. So if we ignore them, we become just like the system. What did Dr. King say? Dr. King said, wherever there was injustice, there am I. Well, we lost that approach. Try getting a civil rights leader and say, hey, come here. You see that town over there and all that news up there? They talking about that town there is racist. Get them up and go in that area. They not gonna do it. You know why? We here, us the little people, ain't learned. We being used. We being abused. Let one of them kids get locked up, you know what they're gonna do? They're gonna say, hey, what's that phone number to Mark Clemens? Okay. Hey, Mark Clemens, yeah, is that you, homie? Sure, man, I really need some help. Say, do you remember me? You gotta think. Say, yeah, man, 4 years ago, man, shoot, I invited you to a meeting. Well, man, I couldn't make it 4 years ago, but I'm here now. Guess what? My whole little world been twisted upside down because they called little Timmy and beat him up and put him in prison. Get the troopers and let's go. And you say, get who? Get the troopers and let's go. Who? I invited all of y'all there. Nobody came. You were the trooper. Do you understand? It's called building a movement. No movement, you can't hold these people to accountability. So in the city of Chicago, I'm pretty sure all of you heard, we got a new state's attorney. Anita Alvarez is gone. Now you bring in an African-American sister, Kim Fox. Just one thing, guess what? I don't care what color you is. You ain't getting my money. Come on, oh, I would just love to meet with you and blah, 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 blah. You get at the table, they say, well, you know, sure. I was just thinking if you could just donate. No. I ain't giving you a nickel, sister. Because when we tell you, you supposed to do your job. And we lost the integrity. Why now does it take $150 to $200 million to get a president in office? People ain't even woke up. They done spent tons of millions of dollars. People on the street, they hungry and can't even get a sandwich. We have built in funding political candidates just this year. We have built drug centers. We have built shelters. We gave it away. That's what we did. So now we go to the government. Well, what about House Bill 366 and it's the bill for the drug? And they say, listen here, we ain't got no money. Get out of here. So you leave and say, well, you mad. But you fail to realize you gave it away. That's why political people, they would never want us in their room because we are a liability to them. There's so many dumb people in society. I hate to say it. And a lot of people say, man, why did you call the people dumb? They are. So if I had like Donald Trump, he always brags. He said, well, I started off with $1 million. Give me $1 million. With the people's mindsets here, you can take that $1 million and you can really come up if you invest it right. And you are invested on a lot because the people don't want to hear the truth. You come to them with the truth. The people be talking about, man, I think there's something wrong with that there, man. But you come to them with a lie, they say, man, right on, brother. You know, man, tell you what, man, I was only going to give you that a little bit, but man, listen, I'm going to give you that. So we have to change our mindset. These are our children out here killing each other, going back and forth to prisons. These are our children that are even being railroaded by the criminal justice. And it ain't their kids. So they go home and they sleep real good and whatnot. They live real good. They steal all our money, get indicted, go to jail, and still come out and get a job. Something wrong with that picture. So I think Just with us few right here, we need to change our mindset. Because if we don't, we're going to lose everybody. There's no love. Sure, I did all the time in prison and whatnot and came out and whatnot thinking that it was still the same way. You know why? All you have to teach you is, guess what? A TV. So you get out and say, well, man, these people gotta have some. I don't believe them people ain't no love out here. You come out here and whatnot, person hit you with a brick. Because they don't care. These people don't care until it happened to them. Once again, my name is Mark Clements. I invested to come here just for you. Hey, I could have went on vacation. Said, man, forget you. Yup. I could have went on vacation, been riding over there like Fair Fawcett, you know, on the beach. What's that movie come out way back in the day? It's called 10. You know, just an old potbelly old man running on the beach. Hey. But I thought of you. Due to the fact that we got to get up, it got to be a start. Got to be a start. It can't just be Black Lives Matter. It can't be just whatever the other little group is and the other little group is. It can't be just blocking the bridges and whatnot. It has to be a scheme to make these people do something that, guess what, they don't want to do. See, and when we tell you, the real good scheme of it is this, and it ain't been done yet. You block that Capitol in New York. You block that Capitol in Illinois. You block these capitals and see what these people do. They are, because now you shut them down. So people say, oh man, that'll never work, man. Yes, it will. Why wouldn't it not work when we can block and shut down the highways? All we doing is blocking little poor people from getting to work and whatnot. How about blocking them from getting to work? We ain't thought about that. So when you bring that, people say, oh man, the police gonna come, man. What you think that is? That's police involvement too. I think that if we want to achieve big, we gotta think big. And we got to think like poor people. Poor people. Want me to tell you? Poor people have the best great minds if they use it. They won't put their resources together. Their resources ain't always money. Their resources could be putting in the work to achieve what we need. Thank you, my brothers and sisters.
I love these two men so much, and now you see why. So I would like, I'm going to sit down. I mean, we can come a little closer if you need to. I think there's so few of us, we could probably hear each other from where you're sitting. But if you have comments or questions for the two of them, maybe scooch a little closer so everybody can see you around the cameras. I don't know. Can everybody see them okay? Okay. Okay. So does anybody have a comment or a question?
Come on. Somebody gotta have a comment or a question.
Does everybody know? I imagine some of you may want to know what happened to John Burge, if anything. Does anybody know what happened to him? And that's the police chief who oversaw the torturing of, is it 200, Mark?
It's over 200. Over 200.
It's over 200. Okay, and what percentage of them have been released?
A very small percentage of them. There's still over 100 individuals still inside of our prison system. John Burge was eventually sentenced to 4.5 years. He did approximately 4 years inside of a federal prison. I think it was Butler in North Carolina. He did his time and he got out. You know.
And kept his pension, did he not?
Still kept his pension. Many of the men are still languishing, their mothers and fathers, many of them have went on. When I say went on, they have perished. They have perished because guess what? Stress can't remain there for decades and decades of years. In the city of Chicago, you got a brother by the name of Stanley Rice. served 31 years in prison. What, based off of evidence that was being concealed, he was a torture victim, but the evidence was being concealed by prosecutors, by everybody as high as the mayor. Back then, the mayor was Richard Deller. So I think, really, the importance of all of this really is not how many people are in the room, what you take from it, how you can link on maybe the little Facebook. Man, I see these kids, man, they're able to do amazing things. It's all about getting in a little tiny little circle and rattling a little tiny circle. The key of it is we all, everybody in this room, believe it or not, is burdened and suffering from something. That's why you're here. That's why you are trying to make a difference. From, matter of fact, Florida to California to Chicago to Indiana, all over the whole globe, people are suffering. And not to cut you off, Sandra, but one thing I would like is for people, all of you, including that young child, and she probably got the most unique question that anyone in this room can ask. I want you to think and ask a question. Thank you, Rochelle.
Mark, for you, what happened to Burge? He's out now and doing what?
John Burge is out of prison. He lives in Apollo, Florida. He's doing great. Oh my gosh. Sure, he's doing real good. So that's what happens, and that's the reason I was making a mention how the politicians and their little hitmen, they can do their dirty work and they get out of prison, and guess what? We, society, we give them a job. But our own flesh and blood, we sit down and we dog them, and we treat them like animals, and we say, guess what? You lazy, bloom, 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 you don't want to work a job. Let me tell you, these guys got to work 3 minimum wage jobs to afford the economy the way things are going out here. And people, it ain't dawned here. In some states, brothers can't even receive education if they went to a prison setting. They can't even move in with their mothers if they're on like Section 8. So those are the hardships that we're dealing with, and what really burns me up as a person is it's really one or two people who came up with all of these dumb, stupid laws, and when we tell you, they roam around us like little bees. Ooh, I love you black people. So we must put the focus where that the focus should be lying. There's no accountability against the Clintons for what they did to poor African American people. No accountability to make this man change these laws. I ain't heard no one in these debates bring this stuff up to Hillary Clinton. That stuff is a shame. So when Black Lives Matters come up to me and say, man, didn't we show up, do you know, you ain't did nothing but waste hot air. You do something whenever, if Hillary come down, you put her on blast. And you make her change. You know what? Your kids caught up in this type of stuff. Some of these kids out here who call themselves activists, they babies now today, having babies. And when them babies grow up, they're going to be the ones that fall into the rim of that system. So people can sit down and they can be talking about what they doing. Listen here, buddy, you ain't doing nothing because you can change that stuff in one day. People just don't think it can be changed. Shut this economy down, not through the stock exchange, Don't let them get to work in one day and see how quick things change. We ain't tried it, so we don't know what to work. Think about that.
What became of Stanley Rice? I remember him.
Well, Stanley Rice is out today. Stanley Rice lives in Chicago. Unfortunately, like many of the torture victims, Stanley deals with some psychological issues in which he has been denied assistance. He's been denied assistance based off of the fact they set standards and categories of who the people can receive the assistance. So yes, he says a great possibility of another $10 million settlement in the city of Chicago. But guess what? Giving you $10 million and you don't hire and spend $10,000 to get an investor, then guess what? You just lost all your money. Believe it or not, money go like that. And you look up and you be like scratching your head. So that's what has happened with the torture victims. Most of them, they haven't found ways how to invest their money in an appropriate manner, and they have spent it. I have problems with people getting all this money and not giving it back.
Giving back, yes. That's a big problem too, yes. Mm-hmm. Fred, I think.
You brought something up that I thought was very interesting, and you're very astute in your comments because you must have done a lot of thinking on that. You said that people who are here are because something happened to them, which I think is true. So my question to you is, how do you get, I mean, it's not really an appetizing subject. How do you get people involved? How do you get people who never experienced something like that to stop being afraid or even to get any interest in what you're saying? How do you get them involved?
Well, let me tell you, here in America, many people have been victimized one way or the other. Here in America, what I've found since being released, people are led to, like, we can go on Facebook, we can curse each other out. Mm-hmm. I got time to do that. I can go on Facebook and I can put all the sexual porn on it. I can put all the young ladies on it, but I don't have nothing that interests me. Want me to tell you, this is a generation of just people today. You never know what a catch fire. You just never, never know. And I know what you're going through. Because I know people in the city of Chicago and beyond who do the same thing, and they have the same outcry. And they like, well, why this ain't catching? But guess what? The kids can come and make a rock song. This is true. And they can go and say, well, lock up John Birch, and it catch fire all over the world. So the thing about it is, there's something I've been thinking about. Why in the world people don't catch on? And I think maybe with us is getting into their inner circle, because these kids, man, they got secret groups and everything else, man. And if you ain't saying that secret code, they not listening to you. And that's the problem with our generation.
That actually brings me to a question for Lawrence, because Lawrence, you mentioned you were 17 when you got involved with the Black Panther Party, which reminds me a lot of the story of Mamiya, who was mere 14 or 15 years old when he got involved. What do you see, just to piggyback on Mark's comment, about that young generation during that time versus today? Any differences, maybe factors? I mean, obviously it was a different time. Like you said, you were growing up in a very actively racist time period. But we're seeing, you know, the new Jim Crow now. We're seeing it's not like racism has disappeared. What can we learn today from those times that got you mobilized when you were just 17?
Well, I know one thing. Racism is very masked. Mm-hmm. It's very masked in the society now. It's behind. Mm-hmm. You know, you discover it later after it's happened to you. But, you know, I think I see this new generation in two parts. I see those that came out of drug-infested communities and drug-infested and dysfunctional families, and I see those kids struggling with the society, you know, and a lot of them are not political. Then I see the kids who came out of homes who had some sense of what I went through, some sense of defiance, some sense of concern, some sense of learn, baby, learn, you know. And I see them on the street. I see them in mixed racial groups, and I see them struggling against basically the system. I think though that we are dealing with the system, and it affects people. What I don't care what race you are, you can be white and be a billionaire, and you are being manipulated by the system. You are being manipulated to hoard that billion, to house that billion, try to make another billion, and every billion you make takes away from a billion people. You see, like I said, I combined two experiences to express what I feel today. I combined what I learned from a wise man who said slavery has been fruitful in giving itself names. It has been called the peculiar institution, the social system, and the impediment. It has been called by a great many names, and it will call itself by yet another name. You and I and you had better wait and see what new form this monster will assume, what new skin this snake will come forth next. And I'm saying to you that Frederick Douglass was not only talking to the African, he was talking to the African abolitionists, and he was talking to the actual people who were perpetuating racism. Because people who perpetuate racism is a part of the victimized system that victimizes all of us. And I think that my experience in the death house is a starting point. I think that if we want to avoid committing the same atrocities over and over and over and over again, the question we must ask before we do anything, before we commit ourselves to anything, is what I am doing, what I am getting myself involved in, does it support the appreciation, value, and respect for life? If it doesn't, then it does not need to be a part of the human race and human development, human evolution. That brings us all together. That crosses all racial lines, economic lines, that crosses all lines to appreciate, value, and respect for life. You see, so combining them two together, recognizing that Frederick Douglass recognized the pattern that this monster will continuously perpetuate itself in, from one generation to the next, and the realization that we all, that's why we're here, because each and every one of us in this room appreciates, values, and respects life. We are here to oppose the death penalty and the injustice that creates the death penalty. So that's my take on basically what you ask.
Thank you. Yes, in the back.
Yes, I'm Jack Stevens. I'm with an organization called Workers' World Party. And I came here, as Fred asked me to stop by, because we were doing some work on political prisoners and formatting some stuff to send to Philly, to Ramona Africa, who's working on the Move 3, Janine, Debbie, Africa, and they got a parole hearing coming up, I think it's May 23rd in Philly. And we just had a meeting here in the Malcolm and Betty Savard Center, raising support for them, dealing with the question that we need to take up concretely, the question of parole and what this brother was saying. What that means to our community, our families, our work, not being able to go out of the state. Our youth need to hear that concretely. I share briefly, right here, we're working on another case from Amir Abdul-Jamal, And we're going to Saint-Denis on the 28th to May 1st to take up MIA continuous work on an international basis, and also the question of hepatitis C and what that means to 10,000 political prisoners in Pennsylvania who are not getting Hep C service, and Mamiya Gould himself, who's affected now by Hep C and is very ill as we speak now. So we have some card here that's dealing with that, because again, Hep C, people need to know what that means and how that relates to the oppressed and working class community, the Black community, the Latin community. How many thousand people have that for so many years, like Mamiya for 28 years, and don't even know it? And then you're sent to prison and you're forced to do prison labor and you're not getting medical treatment for something like this. And they're selling the medication, Pfizer them, for $94,000 a treatment. And even though they're getting Hep C treatment in the prison here in New York and Rikers Island and so forth, and people seem to be pretty proud about that, but we're still paying that $94,000 to these rip-off multinational corporations that got inversion and taking their money in Sweden and elsewhere and not paying taxes here for to get any service, not even giving out syringes or anything or any treatment for HIV AIDS, or a lot of them have HIV AIDS and Hep C. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So now we're at a point where we're dealing with the political prisoners in Pennsylvania. We have these postcards going on that we're sending the governor, we're getting it together in the prison correctional, and we're really trying to get them some concrete help. And we have a doctor, Dr. Harris, who's African-American and an egologist. He studied from Egypt, if I'm saying it right. But he studies it, and he's very professional. So he's lending what this pill in Egypt costs $4. And you're paying that for this here. So some of the shock reality, what I'm saying, like what's happening in Chicago, we need to know really concretely. So I can talk to my daughter and my youth that I work with in video. They need to hear you from Chicago. When you hear these concentration prisons like Guantanamo Bay, and that's in Chicago, and rounding people up and taking them out, it's unbelievable. So I'm glad you're here to share that. Finally, a lot of the former Panthers and political organization is working now on the question of confronting Hillary Clinton and Bill and everybody else on the effective death penalty, on the welfare rights and so forth. And this particular year, we're trying to get an initiative, a referendum on the ballot, dealing with the question of community control of the police. For one, you gotta live in the neighborhood where you control it and so forth. For two, you have to deal with the whole question that we could recall you, you know, like they do in Cuba, like we just saw Obama just came from Cuba. And we raised the question and we explained what Hillary and Clinton did, because it was Hillary and Clinton that dealt with the effective death penalty act.
Yeah.
And we explained it to her concretely to people up and down the street what's really going on with this. So this is what this particular campaign is doing. And most of all, being that it's an election, that it's on a referendum, we get to talk to millions of people, and it will be people who are affected by former Black Panther leaders, community activists, youth, and so forth. And we're trying to bring this out because it's going to take a mass campaign of confronting them and going to their neighborhood and taking their jobs away and not let them have no peace. And you said it right, it can't only be Black Lives Matter, because we are proud that it's a spontaneous movement and they're responding. But it has to be planned, because what they're doing to us is planned. It's super profit, it's planned. It's no chance that all these African-American, everybody else wind up in prison. This is a planned deal. So I'll get y'all information and anything I could do with Fred and the host to get it around here in New York. This is the type of work, it don't matter how small the crowd is, this is the type of work that needs to be done. Mm-hmm.
May I have a comment or a question?
Hi, I'm Richard Lavera. I'd just like to thank both of you for coming and speaking tonight. And Mark, I'd like to thank you for helping me, help Jermaine LeBron, who's on death row in Florida for a crime that, you know, he definitely didn't commit. And, at least the death penalty in Florida was declared unconstitutional. But, today, Jermaine still sits on death row. And But, you know, it's very hard, like you said, to get people to do anything. And you're one of the two people I did find that tried to help. Thank you.
Can I just add, I worked with death row exonerees and religious innocents, and even before I did that, I've known through Lawrence and Mark and Darby Tillis and Kirk Bledsoe, many, many exonerees, that not everybody who has been traumatized, and they all have been, by death row or incarceration is capable or at a given point in their life to do with the work that they do. So the fact that they travel and speak at risk of, you know, telling, re-traumatizing themselves by their own story, much less going into prisons and visiting. I definitely want you to respond to this. Visiting inmates, I mean, you mentioned Jermaine in Florida. Well, Mark's gonna be going with me to visit my friend Jermaine Wright, who is on Delaware's death row, and he's innocent as well, and he's done over 24 years innocent, and he said, I need to see Brother Wright while I'm in town, so we're gonna go Monday morning. He's gonna visit Ghani, a juvenile El Whopper in Pennsylvania on Sunday. So I'm just in awe of both of them and others that I know who are willing to, in spite of their background and what they've survived, still to put themselves at risk. But let me hear your take on that, Lawrence.
I spent 24 years on parole. Mm-hmm. And I spent 24 years, and I can tell you this, because of my activism. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. My lawyer, after 22 years, looked me in the face and said, Lawrence, you're gonna have to stop doing this. You're gonna have to stop going out, and you have to stop talking about these people, because as long as you talk about them, as long as it's how long they're gonna use that ballot against you and keep you on parole. I backed up off. They can tell you I'm a member of the board of the campaign in the death plan. I'm a founding member, and I backed off. 2 years later, I got off parole. That's how systematic this thing is, you know. I take my hat off to him, because Chicago ain't no joke. New York, you can get lost. You can get lost in the cracks of New York. But Chicago, they are serious about protecting the injustice that goes on in Chicago. You need to go back and read about when, what was that man's name again?
John Bird.
No, the man.
Oh, Richard Derry.
Yeah, you got to read about Richard Derry and the mob he had down there. You know, how he ran Chicago. But I just wanted to make that comment to emphasize, that this is a struggle. This is a struggle, and it's going to take people like Mark, people like myself, people in this room. Even you coming out is a message. It says something. That guess what? There are people who are concerned, and there are people who, you know, will come out and listen to and activate. As far as my brother, I wrote a book. I did some research on the Mumia case, and I worked with for a long time with the political prisoner organization. And I would like to get get one of your postcards. Are you online? Can I post this on my page? You know, please, I mean, give it to me. The other thing is, to answer your question, the kids of today are serious. They're serious. And you're not gonna find them too much in these little enclaves like this, in these little meetings like this, because these kids, they ain't playing no jokes. They are not playing any games. They are waiting. They are waiting on the proper people to guide them properly. Right now, they're turning their guns on themselves. You know, they're shooting up each other and all that kind of stuff there. And they're practicing their own personal rage against each other. But they are waiting for leaders. They are waiting for leaders to properly direct them.
on how to deal with the massive oppression, the massive injustice. They're born into this, and they hear Mark, they hear me, they hear you, they see your films on Facebook and with YouTube. They see these things, you see, but they don't know how to respond to them, and they're waiting on some leader. When I joined the Black Panther Party, you know, and I joined the Black Panther Party because I was a black man, and I understood the oppression that they were fighting against. That's why I joined the Black Panther Party, you know. And I'll have you know that a lot of results came out of the Black Panther. They destroyed the Black Panther Party to an extent, but a lot of results came out of it. Your police forces are integrated because of the Black Panther Party. You see, when you go back and you look at that research, that's who we fought. And one of the things we fought for was representation of the black community in the police force, and it happened. When we went and started, we just didn't start breakfast programs. A lot of people don't know, they don't do the research. But all the programs that the Black Panther Party presented in the black community came out of the research that was done in Brown versus Board of Education. When John Henry Clark said, if you send children to school hungry, they're less likely to learn. If you send them to school in tagged clothing, they're less likely to learn. If you send them to school and they look and they see in the books, and they don't see themselves in the books, they're less likely to learn because they're less likely to take an interest in things that will not materialize for them. We helped. I was assigned to Columbia University when the Black Student Union rose up and asked for black studies to be made a basic part of the curriculum. You know, when Professor Howakawi, he was a professor of Columbia University back then. He was a linguistist, you know. He came out and said, you know, he wanted to destroy this movement because it was one of the most dangerous movements in the world, in American society. But what I'm saying is to you that the difference between then and the difference now is that that movement has not materialized yet. Where young African American, Hispanic, we're the young lords, you know, in terms of the, I worked with them back in the days, but we do not have, they do not see the kind of movements they're fed up with Hillary Clinton's John Birch's, and they're fed up with Donald Trump's and the racism and the prejudice, they're fed up with that. But they're just waiting on a movement like the one I got involved in that's gonna make some basic changes in this society. You know, so that's my kick on that. I think this generation, I met two kids. One of them was 7 years old, the other was 11. I mean, two of the smartest kids I ever met in my life. They learn, they pick up stuff like sponges. It's just, what are they picking up? You know, I lived with me for four months. I had an 11-year-old and a 7-year-old live with me for 4 months. And in that 4 months, I love to teach. She tell you that, I love to teach. In that 4 months, I had these kids, they knew about Shaka Zulu, they knew about Hannibal, they asked them now, they know about Shaka Zulu, Hannibal, they knew about Martin Luther King, they knew about, their minds are like sponges. It's just that they are not in those enclaves getting the proper type of knowledge that they need. And those, that when that movement comes along, and I think Mark is saying, it's not going to be a race-based movement. It's going to be a humane movement. Because a lot of these kids are going to school, they're rubbing shoulders, they're talking, they're exchanging with kids of all races, all religions, and all creeds. You see? And I believe that the movement that's going to take off is going to be
a humane, and it's going to be a movement toward a more humane society, a more humane world. And they don't want to hear nothing else. You see, Obama was the last apple they reaching for from the tree. You know what I mean? He put the apple in front of the horse, and the horse go out. That's what, they're not even interested in a black president, whether it's a black president, white president. They're interested in someone who is going to unite the human race.
Thank you, Lawrence, that's great. Anyone else?
Yes, I just need to ask a question. Presently now, like I heard, there's a lot of concentration camp they're building around the country. I cannot remember the name, but something Jane, I think is the name. Remember, what's about those?
Yeah, they not only that, they have tons of coffins of these synthetic coffins all over the country. I mean, and I read an article. I think it's on my Facebook. I published it, you know, on my Facebook page. But you have to look at what's going on now and understand that right now with Trump. And what's the other Creek name?
Cruz.
No, Cruz, right. And Cruz, you know, what they're talking about, they brought over the last 20, 30 years, they brought all these Middle Eastern people to America, offering them a better life, to get away, them and their families a better life, to get away from the devastation of the Middle East. They got them here. And now they're talking about putting them in social, technological concentration camps. You know, that surveillance, constant surveillance, under intelligence, under police patrol and police cover. Those are concentrated. They don't have to build walls no more. You see, they can put a app on your phone and know everything you say and everything you do and everywhere you go. You know, so I mean, yes, there's something in the planning, and I see that. There is something in the planning, and it's not in our favor. You know, it is not in our favor, and that's what frightens me about Hitler. Like, he didn't quite say it, but Bill Clinton left the campaign trail to come back. Where was he from?
Arizona.
To come back to Arizona to sign the death certificate of a man who had been sentenced to death. He came off. And that's the thing that bothers me most about Hillary Clinton, her position on the death penalty. It's like I said, when you look and you make choices, ask yourself, is what going on, is what I'm about to get involved in, does it support appreciation, value, and respect for life? If it doesn't, then you don't want no part of it. Don't spend your money with it. You know, don't support it in any way, shape, or form. Push it aside. I don't care, it could be something that's dear to you. I mean, you know, push it aside. Because it does not support appreciation, value, and respect for life. A lot of these people I watched during the 70s right here in Harlem walk up Lenox Avenue, lock arms, calling for the bill to be passed to make it possible for them to try youth as adults. Now, the same people, like he said, the same people are sitting in courtrooms, old, decrepit, and in pain because their grandsons and their granddaughters are victims of that same law. You see, they're victims of that same law that they went and marched to pass. You know, so we must be careful, and we must have some guide. And the greatest guide that we can have, I think, is to ask ourselves, is what I'm doing, is what I'm getting involved in, what I'm supporting, does it
promote and support appreciation, value, and respect for life. If it doesn't, go about it. Mm-hmm. That's awesome. That's what I believe. That came from the death house. Mm.
That's right. Thank you. Anyone else?
Anyway, thank you all for coming tonight. I really appreciate your time and the love and the interest that you have for these two men and for the cause. You're obviously all together part of this movement, and we're going to all create change together. So thank you once again.
Mark.
It's okay.
I always know him as Clemens, I swear to God. And I always want to say Clemens, but I know his name is Mark. Mark, me and Mark's been doing this for a long time, and the thing I'm starting to realize is that we don't give each other, while we're together, enough love.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I just want to tell Mark, you know, I think he's remarkable based upon what he's been through. And I'm wishing that this, I'm happy. I mean, this is a moment in my life that I appreciate, value, and respect to being able to come out, you know, and be a part of the tour that this young man is involved in. How old are you?
I'm
51. Oh, I'm 64. Okay. I said young man. Okay. But the point is, you know, I want to encourage you to continue doing what you're doing. I love your strength. I love your energy, you know. And I feel much better about the world having you in it. And you know, I just want you to go on and continue. Keep that spirit, keep that energy, you know. I mean, when you come back, I mean, Wednesday, we gonna have a little, you know, we're gonna do our little thing, you know. But I wanted to do that personally. I really did. I got a lot of love and faith for you.
Well, you know, Lawrence, and you know, I was in the prison system when I first was introduced to Lawrence, because I seen him in the new Abolition and standing on the New York courthouse steps. So, you know, the bottom line of it is that we've all suffered in our own little different ways. We've been victimized, but guess what? We still stand, you know. This is a tough journey in your body, you know. So a lot of people say, well, man, what's so tough? But man, trust me, it's tough in your body, flying and traveling and trying to do this type of stuff here. But I do it out of dedication and love for individuals that I already know they suffer. You know, so people can sugarcoat it, they can put it all in type of different ways. At the end of the day, man, we all suffer. Some of us suffering together, some of us suffering apart. So, but thank you, New York. Yeah.